Good morning. Today's lecture is about 19th century Russia, and really this is kind of a catch-all of Russian history from the beginning of Russia up until the 1800s. So I want to start first with early Russian history. And in the 6th and 7th centuries, Viking traders are going to enter the area around what is present-day Kyiv, and it's to establish a trading route between the northern parts of Europe and what is the Byzantine Empire and the city of Constantinople. And when the Vikings go through there, they're going to find this loosely organized group of Slavic tribes. These tribes are based around timber and caviar and fish, amber, furs, things like that. Now, a lot of what the Vikings find as far as government goes has been borrowed from the Byzantines, which means the people around Kyiv, they're using Roman laws and Roman titles and a Roman-style government and things like that. Now, Russia is going to convert to Christianity because Constantinople is going to send people to what is today Russia to convert the locals into Christianity. And the two big names that are going to do it are Saint Cyril and Saint Methodius. Now, Saint Cyril is where the Cyrillic language comes from, because Saint Cyril is the one who is going to create the language used in Russia, the Cyrillic language. And the reason he did that was so that the Christian Bible could be read by the locals and that the Christian church would be understood by the locals. Now, in 989, Prince Vladimir I is going to convert to Christianity, and in 989, the people in his kingdom are going to be forced to convert to Christianity as well. In 1236, the Mongols are going to invade the area, and because of the way that the government worked in the Kievan Rus, there wasn't much they could do. The crown didn't pass down from father to son. There were a lot of competing people thinking that they were the next crown prince. And so the Mongols, they end up seeing a Russian aristocracy that's fractured, a government that's fractured, a royal family that's fractured. And the Mongols are easy, they easily take advantage of it. Now, Russia is going to be cut off from the rest of the world basically for 200 years. So the Mongols are not really forward thinking and liberal or anything like that. They kind of tighten down and keep everybody out. Now, one thing about the Mongols is they didn't really care what you did as long as you sent tax money and listened to the ruler. And so there was tax money being sent to the Mongol capital from what was then the Kievan Rus. Well, eventually a resistance is going to break out a little bit farther north than where Kyiv is, around what is today Moscow. And a prince named Ivan Kalitsa starts keeping some of the tax money for himself, basically skimming off the top. And his power is going to grow as his wealth grows. And eventually his city, the city of Moscow, is going to be the most dominant city in the area. Fast forward to the year 1480, and Grand Duke Ivan III is going to stop sending tax money completely to the Mongols. The Mongols are going to send an army to try and fight Ivan III, and Ivan III is going to defeat this Mongol army. So Moscow is going to be outside of Mongol control. Ivan III is going to become known as Ivan the Great, and really he's going to be the founder of the modern day Russia. Now, this guy here is Ivan the Terrible. Let me move my little screen here. And he really is kind of terrible. He is known as the Grand Prince of Moscow, and he does that from 1533 to 1547. And in 1547, he gives himself a promotion to Tsar, basically Caesar of Russia. And he serves there from 1547 to 1584. He's crazy. I'm not kidding here. He's crazy. Any of his rivals, he executes. His sons, he executes. Rebellions, he crushes. He has a secret police system that is going to watch you everything you do. He marries 7 times. When he is tired of his wife, instead of divorcing her, he kills her. He's going to conquer parts of the Mongol Empire. It's underneath Ivan the Terrible that Siberia becomes Russian. And he's going to create the second class of military nobles. Basically, military aristocrats are going to become equally important to the rich nobles. And that's a way to play one set of nobles against the other, so he stayed in control. Ivan the Terrible is also the reason that serfdom comes to Russia. Now, serfs, remember, they're not slave, but they're not free. And they have existed in Middle Ages. But we're past the Middle Ages when it comes to Ivan the Terrible. We're into the Renaissance. Ivan the Terrible doesn't care. He is going to pass laws binding peasants to their land, and serfdom will exist in Russia from the 1500s all the way up until the late 1800s. After he dies, there's a civil war. Since Ivan the Terrible killed all of his sons, there's nobody really left. There's one son who's young, and it's just civil wars. And people who say that they're Ivan's son try to take over. One person who said he was Ivan's oldest son, Dmitri, he had survived and hadn't actually been killed. Well, he was a fake Dmitri, and according to legend, was shoved in a cannon and shot into Poland. He does have one son named Fyodor. Fyodor dies very young. A new person is elected to be the leader, a guy named Boris Godunov, but Boris dies in 1605. And from there, it's just civil war after civil war, fight after fight, all the way up until 1613. Nobody can win the civil war. So in 1613, all of these royal families known as the Boyars, they get back together and they say, you know what, let's just end the civil war and elect somebody else. And the person they elect is a guy named Michael Romanov, and the Romanov dynasty is born. And the Romanov dynasty, by the way, will exist until 1917. A couple of rulers that I do want you to know specifically. First one is Tsar Peter the Great, and he's going to rule from 1682 to 1725. He overthrew his sister, first of all. It's ruled Game of Thrones style. In 1720, he's going to divide Russia into different provinces. In 1722, he creates something known as the Table of Rank. It's literally a ranking chart. And the higher up you are on this ranking chart, the more important you were to Peter the Great. To make it even more interesting, he says only half of the nobles, only half of the aristocrats can serve any year. So the table of rank has like a table A and a table B. Table A is used 1 year, and table B is used the next year. He sets up a Senate, but the Senate's not like the Senate we have today. It's really more like the presidential cabinet. These senators, their job is to help Peter the Great rule and give him advice. And then we also have a secret police that's going to watch everything you do. On top of that, the secret police, they're going to set up this system of internal passports. So to go from one part of Russia to the other, you have to have a passport. It's not like here where you can go to any of the 50 states. Imagine if you had to have a passport to go to Alabama. That's basically what it is. That internal passport system, by the way, is still used today as far as I know. As far as military goes, Peter the Tsar, he started with a very small army, but he started to draft peasants between the ages of 20 and 25. And if you were drafted originally, you had to serve for life. Peter the Great realized that was a little bit excessive, so he's shortened it to you had to serve for 25 years. So basically, you are drafted at 20 and you serve until you're 45. The number of conscripts, the number of people drafted, depended on how big your area was. The bigger the population, the more people you had to provide. And by 1725, he has an army of 200,000 men. He does the same thing for the Navy. He set up a modern-ish Navy. I mean, modern for the 1700s. Entire forests were going to be used by the Navy and were reserved for naval use. And by 1725, Russia had 800 ships, 28,000 sailors, but these ships were built very poorly. By 1730, of those 800 ships, only about 15 of them were still seaworthy. Let's see, what else did he do? He invades the Ottoman Empire, he invades Sweden, he gains control of what is today St. Petersburg, the city on the Baltic coast, and he names it after himself. And then, Peter the Great, he was in love with French culture and French life, so he started to do everything the French did. He modeled his new city after France, he started to dress like a French person, he started to speak French, and he started to eat French food. He was basically a French pretender. He wanted to be French so bad. Some other stuff Peter the Great does. He had to pay for his military. And a full 80% of all the money that his government raised went to the military. And he had some really weird taxes to pay for this. You had to pay more tax if you were male. You had to serve in the military if you were male. He taxed your beard, he taxed your grave, he taxed if you had windows, and he forced everybody to wear French-style clothes. But if you wanted to wear your traditional Russian clothing, you had to pay a tax for that too. He set up a system of mercantilism based on the French model. He had high tariffs, and the government took control of mines and factories and everything else. Another really interesting he does, the Russian Orthodox Church had a person in charge of it called the Patriarch, and the Patriarch dies in 1700. Peter does not allow the Russian Orthodox Church to replace this person. He's going to personally appoint the Patriarch, and the Russian Orthodox Church becomes an official branch of the government. And the government will run the Russian Orthodox Church until 1917, the Russian Revolution. He westernizes, so he's going to allow free press and printing, but the presses officially belong to the state, meaning that if they start to print something he doesn't like, he can stop them. He allows books on science, technology, and law, but they all have to be translated to Russian. And there are schools set up, but only for the upper class, only for the nobles. Now, eventually, Peter the Great dies. And his succession is not very good. Peter killed his only son. There's 30 years of fighting. And a lot of what Peter did for his reforms is going to be forgotten in that time. But by 1740, Russia, it's still very backwards. It's got a backwards economy. It's got a strong central government. And the peasants are completely under government control. All right, after that, we have Catherine the Great. She's probably even more interesting than what Peter is. Catherine the Great, she's born in Prussia, so she's not even Russian, she's German. She married Peter III in 1762. She learned the Russian language, she joined the Russian Orthodox Church, and then she has her husband murdered. He's overthrown and he's killed in an accident. And it's very likely that this was ordered by Catherine. His own guards are going to strangle him. And Catherine takes power immediately after Peter is dead. So it's very likely Catherine had something to do with this. Now, because Catherine is not born in Russia, she tries to show her Russianness. So she built a large statue that still exists in St. Petersburg to honor Peter the Great, and that is supposed to show how much she honored Peter the Great, the guy who, you know, was the Tsar several years ago. The statue weighs over 15,000 tons, and there's even a legend that as long as that statue stands, that Russia will not be defeated. It's under Catherine the Great that Russia really becomes a world power. She conquered territories. Russia becomes its current size underneath Catherine the Great. She invites in Diderot and Rousseau and some of those other Enlightenment thinkers to live in her palace. She takes a bunch of the ideas of the Enlightenment and tries to use them to her advantage while staying a absolute monarch. She has a lot of rebellions. The serfs, the peasants, they rebel basically once every 2 years. There are something like 40 or 50 rebellions that she puts down, and she remains firmly in control of Russia. I'm going to skip this here. Let me tell you a couple other things about Catherine the Great real quick. She opens the first school for women, but it has to be an upper-class woman who can attend. She had many love affairs. She would take a boyfriend, enjoy the boyfriend, and when she was done with the boyfriend, she would move him into a palace or into a nice house, and then give him some money and give him some serfs. And every time she got tired of a lover, she promoted that lover to an all government office and took a new one. And she would give away thousands of serfs. There's record of her giving away hundreds of thousands of people in one day. Her last lover, by the way, was 40 years younger than her. There's also a rumor that she died on the toilet. That's not true. She had a stroke while using the toilet and then was moved to her bed and then died on the bed. So she's very, very interesting. That's all I've got for you. I'm not going to do the Ottoman Empire because, I'll talk about that a little bit more in a later lecture. But that's what you got for today. So thanks for watching, and I appreciate your time.